Well, good morning. We're glad to see each one here today, and we trust that our time together will be a blessing to you as we worship Christ together. And I want to share just a few announcements to highlight. We have a lot of good things coming up, including today after the service. There is a music group meeting. If you're a part of that, we appreciate your input, and they'll be meeting upstairs. And you have two choices to get there: out through the tent or over the railing there and up. But we'll be meeting after the service for the music group meeting. And there are some good upcoming events involving the music, Resurrection Sunday coming up, and things of this nature, Agape Sunday, which is February 11th. And please take note of the sign-up sheet in the foyer for that day, for the dinner to follow. And also, please remember, as you come for church that Sunday, there's no Sunday school. And we're going to meet at the fire department for the entire service and the dinner. So if you're inviting people, which we encourage you to do for that special day, keep those details in mind as well. Also want to mention, this Saturday is the planned family sledding, and according to the weather reports, it might be 50 by the weekend, which seems to be the normal church sledding party event every year. But if that happens, will we reschedule that? Probably. Sam?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Yeah. You don't just show up at the Savages then. But we'll put out an email if that happens. But please be aware of that. The sledding party is at 10:30 at the Savages' home that morning. If we have snow, it's a go. If we don't, we'll reschedule that. And then next Sunday is our annual meeting, and we have reports to bring to the church that are exciting about the upcoming year, reports related to the addition and the architect's suggestion for our next phase, that he has given us some details that we want to share with the church as a whole. And then one other announcement, your giving receipts, if you haven't taken yours, there's a box out in the foyer that has those for you to pick up. Any other announcements that need to be made? All right, if not, at this time we'll have the prelude, and let me encourage you to begin to prepare your hearts to sing to the Lord and then to receive the Word of God this morning. Thank you. Let's ask God's blessing on our service together. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning and we are rejoicing that Jesus Christ is the center of your plan of salvation. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and that we have a solid rock in Jesus Christ. And we thank you for the salvation that you have freely bestowed upon us that results in the fellowship that we have with you, the fellowship that we have with one another here today. And Lord, I pray that as we gather together as a local church family, that we would desire once again to give Christ all the praise and all the glory as we sing to you. And then as we hear the word of God, we pray that you would use Pastor Mike to bring forth the word of God to once again to exalt Jesus Christ. And we pray that it would be an encouragement. We pray that it would be a challenge to us here this morning. And Lord, we do thank you for this church that you have given, that you have built. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to guide and direct in everything that we do. We pray that it would be your will. We pray that it would be pleasing to you. And Lord, we pray that you would be pleased to use us as a local church in the fulfilling of the Great Commission. And we just again look for your grace and your power to be at work. And now we pray for each one here today. We pray your blessings on each one. We pray that you would meet the needs that are represented here today as you have promised to do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Forever I'll love you, forever I'll He makes no mistake, he knows. played out and how they've kind of given us a little bit of an idea how things were going to look. But now that we see it being built, makes complete sense. And it's, for me, an important lesson about the blueprints. Well, we're actually today going to talk about blueprints of the temple. And, of course, when we start thinking about what is that temple, the temple that we are thinking of is Christ and Christ alone. And the passage we're going to look at is found in John chapter 2, verses 12 to 22. So if you want to, kind of sneak ahead and look that up or put your thumb in there, that's fine. But for me, I want to just, first off, thanks for the opportunity to speak today. It's one of those things I've, pastors in between series, so it's a good time for me to sneak in. But also, he's had his hands full, I'll be honest. Keep praying for the guy. A lot of stuff going on, a lot of pieces moving around. Even himself, he's been in four different offices in the last month. So you never know where he's going to be now in the church. So I figured, give him kind of a week where he can kind of catch up a little bit. And so I asked if I could speak, and he was obliged me a bit. But we're going to talk today about the blueprints of the temple. And the temple of Christ is very important too, because as we see, this passage clearly displays that there's a plan and a purpose for what Christ did for us. Many of us already might know this ahead of schedule, but the fact is, that's kind of our focus today. What is the plan and the purpose of that temple, of Christ Jesus, and how does it affect our daily life? I want to read the passage to you, John chapter 2. And as we look through this, just kind of follow along. Picking up at verse 12, says this: after this, referring back to Jesus turning water into wine, that wedding where he kind of helped out, it was his first miracle that we have recorded. So that's kind of after this. He went down to Capernaum, he, his mother, his brothers, and his disciples. And they did not stay there many days. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and he found the temple in the temple those who sold ox and sheep and doves and money changers doing business. When he had made a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple, and with the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overturned the tables. He said to those who sold doves, "Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise." Then his disciples remembered, as it was written, "Zeal for your house has eaten me up." So Jews answered, said to him, "What sign do you show to us, since you do these things?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" He was speaking of the temple of his body. Therefore, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this to them. And they believed the scriptures and the word which Jesus had said. Let's pause for a moment and have a word of prayer. Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to come before you. Thank you for being able to open up the word of God and read what's in there. But Lord, may it not just be something that we read and kind of just think about for the next few minutes. May it's something that touches our hearts. May it be something that reaches into us, Lord, and helps us to, first off, be reminded of what you did for us upon the cross. And Lord, that you are the temple that was broken and built again in 3 days. But Lord, may it be also something that hearkens unto someone's heart right now, that they might need that temple. They might not know the blueprints of salvation. They might need to know you as their Lord and Savior today. And I pray that might be the case for someone here sitting, listening to this sermon. Lord, I pray that as we speak, as I speak, Lord, may it be your words that come forth. May you hide me behind the cross, and may that temple, Christ Jesus, be magnified by what is said and done. Thank you again for this opportunity. It's in your name we pray. Amen. As we look at the idea of Jesus being the temple, again, that blueprint set in place was something that, to me, I was thinking in just down the road, how can we talk about this temple? What's the importance of it? And it's one of those things that it seems easy for us to understand, that Jesus is the temple. So when we talk about the blueprints, it makes complete sense. So we're going to look through this passage, and first off, we're going to look at the disturbance in the temple, starting at verse 12. And as you look at this, interesting note, first off, the audience that he has written here before this disturbance. His audience is who? Well, verse 12 tells us it's he, his mother, which is interesting because we see see her pretty much by his side all throughout his ministry. If you ever do a study of Mary, she's there at the very beginning, obviously. I don't need to explain that one. We just celebrated Christmas. but, you know, you see her there at that point. You see her, you know, right here at the wedding, then soon after. You see her at the cross. You know, she was a very active part of his ministry. So it's good to have a mom supporting you. My mom will probably watch this tomorrow, so I'll give her a shout out. Thanks, Mom, for support. So it's one of those things where, again, it's good to have that background. Well, does it mean that everyone supports you? No. As you can see also listed here, it's his mom. You also have his brothers. Well, interesting side note, at this point, his brothers didn't believe in him. His brothers, not until later on when he rose again, were very skeptical of him being the Christ, the Messiah. Which to me seems kind of crazy because these are the ones that grew up with him. This was the ones that probably, in a sense, almost despised him, it seems, just because, again, he was that child. Can you imagine having the perfect brother or sister? Some of you guys, you know, might have that child, that one always seemed to do everything right. They did. I mean, plain and simple. Jesus never sinned. He lived a sinless humanity. So can you imagine having him as an earthly half-brother? It's one of those situations, again, it's kind of ironic when you stop and think about it, but his brothers did not believe in him. You see that kind of mentioned also the passage, if you want to cross-reference, is in chapter 7, verse 5, and it talks about Jesus kind of being called out and mocked by his brothers. Well, if you say who you are, go show yourself. You know, they're almost mocking him because he claims or is showing himself to be the Messiah. So even his own brothers didn't accept him. So sometimes when you think about ministry and how it being difficult at times, or even with ourselves as we serve the Lord, there are often conflicts, and sometimes even conflicts within our own home. Jesus understands that. He understands the troubles that may arise up even within your own household, because he had that in his own house. So interesting note, not where I'm going with this whole thing, but I just wanted to mention that to you, that even his own brothers didn't accept him. You do see later on, James writes the book of James. You do see 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it does talk about the brothers that believed in him. So they do come around, but it seems after his resurrection. So interesting note there. So you see the audience, his mom, his brothers, the disciples, probably not all 12 at this point, and you know, it's early in his ministry. He just turned water into wine. It's just starting to get rolling here a little bit. So needless to say, it might not be all his disciples, but at this point, they just really are getting to know him. You know, he's only done the one miracle per se, and even that was kind of hushed. So when you think about, you know, they're listening to him, they're accepting him, but what are they really listening to? What are they really accepting? What do they really desire? Well, we'll touch on that in a little bit. We talk about some of their preconceived notions. But even at this point, the disciples, they're fresh. They're kind of raw at this point. They're just getting to know Jesus. So interesting to note that. But also you see him going down to Capernaum, then going up to the Passover. It's really talking about elevation. Whenever you see in scripture he went up to a place or he went down, it's talking about actually map, like an elevation. So it's interesting little side note. Why I said that, I don't know, but I just thought maybe someone would wonder about that. So as you look at this though, you see him kind of now going, verse 13, to the Passover. And it's one of those situations where obviously, you think about it, how important was the Passover to someone who was a proper Jew? We don't quite understand even the full complexity of that. We come to church on a Sunday morning. We, you know, in a sense, you know, come worship, and many of us head home or go to dinner or do something else or maybe watch a certain game later on. But the fact is, it's just one of those things where, again, you know, a proper Jew, when it came especially to the Sabbath, they had ritual and they had rules that basically dictated to their very day what they could do and what they couldn't. You know, it was something that when they had these different feasts, it was very important for them to come in the proper mindset and in the proper way. I've been reading, I started with January. I don't do this often, but I wanted to read through the Bible every year kind of type of thing. So I started fresh, Genesis chapter 1, January 1st. And I'm not going by a schedule. I know there's different schedules you can follow. I'm just kind of reading. If I come across the verse that kind of jumps out to me, I'll go back and research it and stuff like that. So again, just kind of what I'm doing. But you know, obviously starting at Genesis, the last few weeks I've been in Exodus and Leviticus, just got done with Numbers, now I'm in Deuteronomy. And it's interesting because as I read through the books of Moses, all the rituals and all the rules they had to follow, I'll be honest with you, it had to be exhausting. So all the different sacrifices, and then you often would need a sacrifice in order to bring this sacrifice. You had to prepare and do this sacrifice first before you could give that sacrifice. There's a whole lot of sacrifices. And it's one of those things that, as, especially in the days of the tabernacle, again, we're talking temple here, but again, just set the precedent of what a proper Jew would do. So as you think about the Passover at this point, they're coming together, they're coming to the temple in Jerusalem, and obviously this is something that's important to those who considered themselves a pure Jew, a proper Jew. Now, I do want to reference this, and I do have the reference there of Matthew, chapter 21, verse 13. He also does that thing with the temple where he overturns tables again. And that's later on in his ministry. So it's a different reference point, okay? There's two different events, and I just want to make sure that's precedent. And so sometimes it almost seems like the same event, but there's different words that are shared, different thoughts and sentiments, and that's just before he goes to the cross. This is early in his ministry. So just to kind of set a timeline there. But as we think about the audience, we also think about somewhat the atrocity. What's going on in the temple? Well, he strolls into the temple, and obviously it's a holy time. It's the Passover. And as he strolls into there, he notices the animals that are there that are supposed to be used for the sacrifices. Now, that's proper. Nothing wrong with that. But what's being improper is the way they're being merchandised. Because it's all about the merchandising. So you think about it somewhat, you know, they're selling it more or less for profit. They're making interest. They're selling jacked up prices. You know, the whole rule of supply and demand. Well, there's a demand for these animals because obviously not everyone can have different sheep and oxen to bring for sacrifice, so they have to buy it at the temple. And so the prices are, you know, jacked up and skyrocketing. So because of that, that's where kind of his anger starts creeping in. Now, and we'll talk about that in a second, but obviously the atrocity is the way they're doing this, is the way they're trying to make money off of this. And really, in a sense, they're selling it for profit. They're not doing it to serve the temple or to serve the people. They're really making money off of this. You know, and maybe there's a time and place for that. I mean, I'm not saying don't sell stuff for a profit. So if you have something Facebook Marketplace right now, don't cancel what you're trying to sell because, oh. No, I'm trying to say this, is that they were purposely in the temple to help provide animal for the people, not to get rich. It's the location that was the problem. Not selling product, but the fact is how they were doing it and what they were doing it for. They were trying to make money off these people. And so that interest, that charge they were giving to the people, that was a huge issue for them at the time. And that's what Jesus starts to kind of feel his anger start arise. And he's walking around a little bit more and more. You know, it's interesting because emotion gets to a point where he actually picks up basically some strands and starts shooing, I don't know if it's proper or not, the animals out of the way. Busting down gates, he starts overturning tables. This is not the picture of Jesus that we imagine often, is it? We imagine Jesus growing up as a kid. I remember in church, up in the nursery, we had a picture of Jesus holding a lamb, you know, and just a beautiful picture of Jesus, you know, with the lamb. And you think about that, that's often our view of Jesus because, you know, Jesus is love, right? But because of the sin of the people, and again, their hearts, their intent, there was anger. Now, and that's something that we need to talk about here a little bit, because that emotion is of the flesh. Remember this, Jesus was of the flesh, but also God at one. Man, God, and one. He had human emotion, just like you have human emotion. He felt what you felt. There's times where he felt pain. There's times where he felt sorrow. There's times where he had to get away into the wilderness and pray. Why? Because he needed to recharge the batteries. Sometimes, you know, he went through different situations just like you do. That's why when we read in Hebrews 4 that he was tempted in all ways as we are, yet without sin. That's the important part, because he was human just as we are, and he is just as we are. But the difference is there's a twist. Fully God, fully man. So his anger, which is righteous anger, it wasn't sinful anger. Ephesians chapter 4, and I know this one because I've been told it a couple times in my life. Be angry and sin not. So I don't know why I was told that one, but the fact is, again, the idea is the anger is not an issue. The emotion is not the issue within your heart. It's what you do with it. It's how you respond accordingly. All of us go through different emotional feelings. All of us have, at times, anger. step out and drive out on the highway. You're just times where you get angry, right? You know, you want to tailgate people, you want to honk horns and stuff like that. I mean, that was just on my way here. Just joking. I just came down a river road. It wasn't that bad. But the fact is, again, you think about it, emotion is very real. What we do with that emotion is what's the difference. Jesus handled his emotion in a proper way. May seem a bit aggressive, but he definitely got the point across. Even to the point as he's doing this, you know, verse 15, he drives them out. And he says, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of merchandise. And it's interesting for me because even there, the wording is very specific. And you can see that in a sense. Because, again, that emotion is a test of faith. He was showing what he truly believed. This is my father's house. How we respond according to that emotion is part of what I'm addressing here somewhat. That is our test of faith, how we respond accordingly. Do we do it with a discerning heart, or do we do it with a despising heart? You know, those are the things where we have to kind of realize that. But Jesus was faultless in his actions. You know, what he did was proper. Even to the point, if you look at this, and here's kind of even a small detail. Notice he says this even down here. Verse 16, to the ones who sold doves, said, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of merchandise. Notice with the doves. The doves were the offerings for the who? What type of people? They were for who? The poor people, right? But also, what happens when you overturn a table full of doves and open up their cages? Gone. All these other animals, they probably could have corralled and got back. In some sense, yeah, there was a maybe a loss of income because for a while there they had to regroup and kind of get their merchandise back together. But the reality is he didn't, you know, completely destroy these people's livelihoods. You know, even in a sense of his righteous anger, there's a sense of control. Because again, he's basically not overturning the doves, not opening up the cages and letting them fly, because once they do, they're probably not coming back unless they're retrieving doves, which that's kind of cool, but I don't know if that's the case. So, but the reality is that if you look at that, even that, there's a sense of control. But notice his statement, my father's house. Why is that important? Because basically what is he claiming to be at that point? I am part of the Father. It is my Father. And that makes me the Messiah. There's ownership there. There's a privilege there. There's a certain aspect of who he was and who he is to this very day of being Christ, God the Son, part of the Trinity. I kind of imagine it like this, and maybe this is a lame example, but I remember years ago watching The Lion King, not the remake, because I just can't do the remakes, okay? But the fact is when you had, you know, Mufasa. You know, you had Mufasa up on the top of the hill, and you have little Simba, and he says, look out over your kingdom. This someday will be all yours. And it sounded a lot more cool because it was James Earl Jones who did the voice. So it sounded better. But the idea was is that, you know, this is your kingdom because you are my son. This will be yours. You know, and that was the lesson from Lion King. But it's kind of the same concept here, though, isn't it? I mean, in a sense, we already know this is his kingdom. This is his world. You think about it. Even Jesus, you know, as we think about being, take for example, John chapter 1. You know, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Go to Colossians chapter 1. What's it talk about? All things were created by him, for him, and, you know, all in him, by him, and for him. You know, so when you think about who he is the creator. This was his house, because he's God. So as he makes that statement, I truly believe, and based off of what I see in this passage, it got people's ears to kind of perk up a little bit. And they're like, what? Whose house is this? This is, you know, this is God's house. And he's basically saying, no, that's my house. That would have raised some alarms there. And again, you can see that because they do question that as we go through this passage a little bit. So as you dwell kind of on this, you know, you see the sense, the authority that he kind of gives there is that this is my father's house. Now it's interesting too that the reference point here, the disciples remember later on, basically verse 17, zeal for your house has eaten me up. That idea of zeal sometimes almost has the idea of envy. Depends on how it's used. But the idea of zeal there almost has the idea of a passion for or some kind of way of protecting. To me, just to give you another quick little reference point or story, years ago when we lived on a reservation, we had a German shepherd who weighed in probably well over 100 pounds. And let me tell you, it's a fun dog to have, but man, there was a whole lot of hair. But the point is that at the time, I was bivocational in that ministry at that church. And so I had to leave at 9:30 at night, and I wouldn't come home until 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning type of thing. And so the dog would be on watch. And we had lower windows. And you could actually, I know, the dog would actually walk around and look out the windows. And the dog was watching to make sure everything was going on. You know, and when I came home, you know, it would meet me at the door and I'd give it a little high five, you know, a little paw. And it'd be kind of like transferring the power ship. Okay, you're off duty. Okay, you can go rest. And now I'm in charge watching over. So why do I share that? Because the dog was zealous to keep watch over that house. The dog was protective of the house. So when the disciples write this, that's kind of that mindset that they're giving, is that Jesus was protecting his Father's house. He was zealous for it. So that's a key phrase when you look at this. So that's important. Now, as we move through here a little bit, more, we realize that the man's made in the temple. Verse 18 kind of jumps out at us. So the Jews, and they're probably shocked to see one man overturning tables. I mean, they're probably thinking, A, he's probably nuts. B, who is this guy? I mean, the list can kind of go on from there. But the reality is they stop, basically, and say, what sign do you show to us since you say you do these things? And I want to kind of peel that back a little bit, a couple layers here. First off is they needed a little bit more. What signs? You say this is your house, your Father's house. What signs do you give? They want proof. But isn't that our human nature, though? Is we need to see something for us to truly believe it. It's referred to as often as easy beliefism, just because, again, it's easy to trust in something that you know that's there, something that you see can touch. That's easy faith. That's faith that sometimes it doesn't take much energy because it's existing already. It's there. True biblical faith is believing in something that is not quite evident. Because that's when we read Hebrews chapter 11, it tells us that faith is what? The things not seen, the evidence of things not seen. So as we dwell on that somewhat, they want more signs. They want to know, if you say you're the one who, this is your house, show us. Now at this point, we only have the turning water into wine. We know later on, there's more miracles. But even in that, would it really change their minds? And the answer is no. Going back to my reading in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. How many signs did Jesus show Moses, Aaron, and the people of Israel at that time? I mean, they went through the plagues. They had the crossing of the Red Sea. Even when they had a fire, a pillar of fire and a pillar of cloud guiding them, water coming out of rocks, every day being fed manna, well, 6 days, quails, which I'm sure after a while you had to come up with new recipes for that one. I don't know how you make manna and quail together, but you know. So when you look at that, there is always signs being shown to those people. But God still called them stubborn and rebellious. Why? Because they kept on needing more. You look at our culture today, even if we showed miracles, and that's where we're not miracle workers here. God is the miracle worker. He does amazing things, but it's a different type. So when we think about, even if we're able to do those things, would it really sell people? Would it really tell them what really God is about? No. Because it's not what you see, it's what's in here. It's a heart. And so that's addressed somewhat by what these guys are saying. Hey, you know, we need more signs. But also they're kind of saying this too as you look at this. Was it necessary? What signs do you show us since you do these things? Well, since you're doing this, was this really necessary? And who do you think you are in order to do this? Kind of calling out, who do you think you are? You know, if I was in a library, say for example, we go to library quite a bit over in Beville, and you know, some people are being loud. Now I had this case the other day where the guy was at the help desk. Hey, maybe just, I don't know, hard of hearing, but like, man, he was loud. You know, and I'm like, I wanted to be like, shh, library. But he's talking to the librarians and they're trying to help him. And so again, I'm just sitting back. I'm like, well, they have the authority. You know, they're the ones in charge. I almost wanted to be like, and pull out like a fake badge and be like, library authority, you need to be quiet. You know, but obviously that didn't quite happen. So the reality is I didn't have the authority in that sense. You know, I'm not the one who has the charge. I'm not the one who has that power. So what are they asking Jesus? Who made you, who do you think you are in order to do this? To drive out the animals, to overturn tables? To act like a crazy person? Who are you? Who do you think you are? And Jesus is basically now going to give him an answer that kind of leaves him flabbergasted. It's interesting because on the surface, it may seem simple statement, and I've read this passage many times, but let's look at it. Verse 19, Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." My point of destroying this temple, in a sense, it's an amazing statement because what's he doing here? He's talking about himself. And to us, looking in hindsight makes complete sense looking backwards. But in a sense, he's giving a preview of what? To destroy this temple. The temple must be destroyed. The body of Christ must suffer because he's referring to himself. I must be sacrificed. Here's the thing. They probably were just flabbergasted he would say something like that. Because what's the first thing they're looking at? First off, they're thinking what? He foretells his suffering here. Basically, I'm going to have to suffer. I'm going to have to die. Destroy this temple. But he also gives a purpose here. I will destroy the temple, but in 3 days it will rise up. Yeah, he's foretelling exactly what's going to happen. Now, if I was to tell you today there's a big game on TV, and I think a certain team's going to win by 35 points, okay, that would be probably very optimistic, personally. But the fact is that you probably wouldn't believe me because what does he know? So it's one of those things where, again, fortune-telling, one of those things a lot of us kind of, it's just not our thing, and it shouldn't be because that's not really the will of God. That's what we're always seeking for. But it's interesting to see him say something like this, in 3 days I'm going to do this. And they're just probably scratching their heads like, what? What's going on? What are you saying? You're going to destroy the temple? And they're thinking, how can one person A, do that? That just seems crazy. The temple that he's referring to, and this is important to note too, they had various stages of temples, 3 of them technically. You had Solomon's, which was destroyed in the days of Nebuchadnezzar. It was rebuilt there afterwards, after the exile was over with, and they come back, and you have, that period of basically the temple's rebuilt, but it's not to its former glory. And I always thought it was interesting as you read, and I didn't have this written down, but I'm just thinking about some of those men who remember the old temple, and when they see the one that was built, they almost cried. Some were crying because they were happy for the new temple, and other ones cried because just not what it used to be. One of those sayings, basically, remember those good old days? That's kind of what they were at, basically. They remembered the good old days of the other temple. So you have that temple. Then here comes along Herod the Great, as he liked to call himself. So anyone who calls himself the Great, you got to worry about the guy's kind of ego and moral compass. But he called himself Herod the Great. I don't know if he actually called him that, but that's how everyone remembers him. But the fact is that he comes in and he wants to rebuild the temple because he's trying to prove to the Jews that he's the man. And that's kind of not biblical way of putting it, but that's how I'm going to describe it. And so he rebuilds the temple, of course, the way he goes about it, using slave labor and other means to do it, bits of corruption and other things, probably not the best way. But he rebuilds the temple, and it takes roughly 46 years, and even at that point of days to Jesus is there, it's still not complete. There's still projects going on. Because it's like any house. It's always being built and rebuilt and always projects being worked on. So needless to say, but that's the obvious thing for them. So as you think about the temple they're referring to, that's the one they thought of. But he's telling what the real purpose of that temple being him. Even in the Old Testament, the temple, the tabernacle, whatever pointed to who? Pointed to Christ. The reasons why they had those sacrifices, the reason why they offered up the animals and gave the blood. Why? Because it pointed to Christ, the Messiah. And so he was always part of that process. And so as we dwell somewhat on this, going back to the purpose, we know his resurrection being on that third day makes complete sense to us, but to them, again, it was probably a bit of a mind scratch. There was kind of, what? But you notice he says, even here, he makes it somewhat personal. I will rise up the temple on the third day. Because he's who? He's God. Now, God the Son, there's a relationship there with God the Father, God the Spirit. All of them are involved in the resurrection. And so it's one of those things where, in a sense, he did rise up. And he was part of that. So it's interesting just even with the very wording about that. So as we dwell on verse 19 and talking about destroying this temple, again, now they were reacting in a sense. So you tell this stuff, you say these things, and in a sense, he's kind of foretelling this process. But did they understand it? Again, if I use that illustration of foretelling something, it's hard to understand, you know? That's why, again, for us, if we, you know, jumped ahead, if we're able to time travel and go forward in time 20 years and only see a couple minutes of time and then jump backwards, would it even really make sense to us? No, because what's going on, the context, all the other things are just confusing. I love the idea of time travel. That's not why I'm preaching here today. I'm just kind of just mentioning it to you. But the idea, though, is it's confusing. I love books about that and movies about that. But to understand what's going on, you have to be part of it. So he's foretelling something in the future. He's saying this is going to happen. But it's confusing, especially to the people of the time and place, because, again, they don't understand the complete context. So as we look at this, what are some of the responses? Demonstration of the temple, verses 20 to 22. First off, some of them are looking at this practically. Well, it took us, you know, 46 years to get to this point. How is he going to do it in 3 days? That's a practical point, isn't it? You know, we thought about this project, you know, and they're saying it's going to take 2 months or something. I forget exactly what they quoted us, but needless to say, and some of us thought, oh, that's achievable. Another thought, well, it's construction. You just never know. So, you know, so far we're on track, it seems, and everything's going well with this project right over here. But again, if they were to say, we're going to get it done in 3 hours, either you're thinking, ooh, I need to hire them because they're awesome, or B, these guys are nuts. Probably more of the second one. So the reality is that when we stop and dwell looking at this, some of them looked at it practically. You know, they believe in what's known, what's here, what's now, and what's seen. And that sometimes creates a void of faith in God's ways versus man's wisdom, because we can't always understand what God is doing. Even salvation itself, to many, is confusing. Why is it confusing? Because to understand that Jesus would come as a perfect sacrifice for us to go to the cross, die, rise again 3 days later, that takes faith to accept that. For grace are we saved through faith. That's part of it, isn't it? But understanding that that salvation comes from him. He is the one. So there's a practicality that for us, we have to overstep in a way. We have to kind of push beyond that practical thinking. Why? Because Christ died for our sins. That takes faith to believe. So that void sometimes is difficult because our wisdom, we want to think things like this. Some of us are very much, we love checklists. Some of us are not checklist people. We're just the ones who have to read the checklist. That's me. You know, but it's one of those things where, you know, you need to have this and this and this and this. You know, I need to be forgiven. I need to be basically, you know, I need to feel this way or this. You know, when it comes to coming to God, we feel like there's a checklist. Like, my sins are too much. Look at this list way over here. It's too long. He can't take all these sins. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There's no one righteous, none, not one. Wages of sin is death, but what? The gift of God is what? Eternal life. So that practicality kind of gets dissolved, doesn't it? Because Christ isn't about practical. He's the Almighty God. He's a Savior who sacrificed himself. There's also kind of a preconceived notions here somewhat. Notice the disciples, as you look at this somewhat, of course, verse 21 says he's speaking of the temple of his body, talking about him sacrificing himself. Verse 22, therefore, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he said this to them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Key phrase there is when he had risen from the dead. Meaning what? At that point when he first did that and said those words, they didn't get it. You know, why? Because they had preconceived notions. They think God's going to do this for me. He's going to come back and set up his kingdom. He's the Messiah. And it wasn't that the question they were always asking Jesus anyhow? When are you going to set up your kingdom? They asked that, I forget how many times, I looked it up one time, but many times throughout the Gospels, you see them asking that same question. When are you going to set up your kingdom? And when you do, can I sit on the right hand or the left hand? It was another little squabble they had. But the reality is that you look at this, their preconceived notions were what? That basically, you know, they didn't quite understand what Jesus was talking about. They didn't get it until after he rose again. They wanted the kingdom then, but that often clouded their vision. Isn't that sometimes the case with us? Things we want, our desires, our needs within us, cloud what my God, cloud what my God have for us? Because we want it this way. In our relationships, sometimes we want things done this way. And it kind of clouds the relationship. Why? Because we have to have it this way. And what they're doing is wrong. Well, maybe it's just their way of doing it. And so sometimes we have to kind of think about that somewhat. But even spiritually, think of the same thing. And that relationship we have with the Almighty God. Sometimes we have preconceived notions. Well, he needs to do this, this, and this. He's God. Doesn't have to do anything. It's us who have those preconceived notions. Well, if God would do this, if my team wins today, then I'll give my life for God. Well, what if they lose? That's one of those things where you see some of the players in football. The one guy even yesterday lost that he's been noted. He was the one that was this big story this week. When he first was interviewed, he gave the glory to Jesus Christ, his Lord and Savior, last week when he won the game. And then when it was re-edited, basically throughout this week, they took out that whole part about his Lord and Savior being Jesus Christ. Odd, but doesn't surprise us, does it? So then yesterday he lost, and I was trying to see if he actually said something, but they didn't show the full interview, so I don't know. but it's interesting to see that, even in sports media, sometimes you have those that, say things, but again, is it God when he's good, or when things go good? Is he just God when, it's handy? Is he God when things are going well, when you win the game, or is he God at all times? Okay, again, we have preconceived notions. So the disciples had preconceived notions. And they're saying basically what? Well, he seems to like the Messiah. We're going to follow him. But it wasn't until really afterwards then they understood about rebuilding the temple. Now, I think of all the different times they heard different, sayings from Jesus. I'm the bread of life. I'm the salt of the earth. All these different things that were explained to them. It's practical ways of looking at who Jesus was. In earthly ways, kind of demonstrating heavenly principles. And so even saying the temple, referring to himself, a temple is a shrine or a building, basically of worship, according to Webster's. But isn't that who Christ is? But then also it's interesting because when we think New Testament, also it says what? We are a temple of the Holy Spirit. When we know Christ Jesus as our Savior, we become a temple of God. And he dwells within us. That's an interesting thought. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3 mentions it. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 talks about it even a little bit more. But the idea that we're a temple of God. So that shouldn't make too much confusion for us. But in the same sense, those preconceived notions kind of sometimes slow us down or they stop us from basically going forward. But the real idea of him saying that I am the temple that will be destroyed and rebuilt in 3 days really shows the pardon that he was offering his physical body. He was willing to sacrifice himself. Rise again the 3rd day. And it shows us that salvation is of the Lord. Why is that important? That's the message of the cross. That's the message that all of us need to hear. That's what the world needs to hear. That Jesus came to die for our sins and rose again on the 3rd day. And because of that, we now have eternal life. Many of us love John 3:16, but what's the purpose of that verse? Is to what? Remind us that if we believe in him, the result is what? Everlasting life. So when we think about Jesus saying these statements, how they were received vary from person to person. Just as what I'm saying about Jesus, going to the cross, rising again, giving us salvation, because salvation is of the Lord. It's received differently by different people. I can't answer for you. Someday you will stand before the Lord and you'll have to give an answer what you did with that temple, what you did with those blueprints, what you did with the Word of God, the message that it gives to us, that Jesus was the temple, suffered for us, was rebuilt in 3 days, rising again. That you'll have to answer for. So as I think about my thoughts here, kind of wrapping this up somewhat, first thought is, have you read and believe in the blueprints of Christ's salvation? That's important because, again, you'll be the one that stands before him someday and have to give an answer. You can say, that church is full of hypocrites. I will never go back. No, that doesn't absolve you from anything. You could say, I'm too bad of a person. I hear a lot of different, as I talk to people even out in the street sometimes, out and about, it's one of those things where you hear all these different excuses. There's no excuses before God. He knows everything about us. Why? Because before creation, he knew about us. So when we stop and think about, as we stand before him, what have we done with his blueprints of salvation? Jesus said himself, I am the temple. 3 days, then I will rise again. Do you accept that? Do you understand that? If not, please talk to someone today about it. Pastor John will be out there shaking hands, kissing babies, all fun stuff. But the fact is, again, he's there for a purpose, just to kind of check with you. Talk to me. I'll be wandering around. Again, talk to someone else you may trust. But do you know Christ as your Savior? So that as Christ kind of shared those words, rebuild the temple, or tear it down, in 3 days rebuild it, many would be confused by that. Are you still confused today? For some of us, we know Christ is our Savior. It's one of those things that, we trust him. We believe in him. But how are you keeping track of his blueprints? Are you still building on that solid ground? Think about it. How is your relationship going? Time to have that relationship chat. Remember when they had magazines years ago, and often you'd have those relationship checklists, I never took those, but back in the days they would have something like that. And so I guess here's a relationship checklist for you. Are you in the Word of God? How do you know the blueprints unless you're looking at the blueprints? Are you studying the Word of God? Are you spending time in prayer? Are you living a life that is properly according to his word? What good is reading the word if you don't live the word? As you think about building upon that rock, do you trust him? Not just when things are good, like an athlete, thanks the Lord afterwards, but do you trust him when things are rough? Do you trust him when things are maybe not going the way you'd like? Yeah, those are ways we trust and keep building upon that rock. Recently, this last little bit, we've come to realize the joy of home owning. Honestly, for the last, how many years of ministry, I've always had a house provided. I had some kind of parsonage or something. And so actually owning a house these last few years has been a bit difficult for us, in a sense, because it's been a growing curve for us. You just can't call someone and have them fix it. Be like, hey, Deacon so-and-so, the water's leaking in the toilet. Can you, now it's us. We have to fix it. We have to take care of things. And when there's problems at the house, we have to kind of figure it out. And I'm okay with being handy, but I'm not really Mr. Handy. So, so it's one of those things where I see that. Kids are laughing a little bit. I can do basic jobs, but it's an ongoing task, isn't it? To keep up a house. You can fix it, have a fresh new built house, but it's going to have to continue to have work done on it and always take care of it. That joy you have in Christ, being built upon that rock, that foundation, him being your temple, your tabernacle, your place that you come to, it's going to take continual work. It's going to take continual effort on your part as you build upon that relationship in Christ. So that's my challenge to the rest of us here. Are you still building upon that relationship? Are you still building on the temple being Christ Jesus? I can't answer for you guys, as I said, but as I was thinking about this sermon today, I really wanted to present basically this truth, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. There's a plan and a purpose to why he came. Plan was for salvation. Purpose was to give us hope, not just here and now, but for all eternity. Because in ourselves, being sinners, we can't do it. In him, and him alone, we have a way. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for the ones that are gathered here, Lord. And I pray that may the message be very clear. The blueprints were laid out. You are the way, the truth, and the life, Lord. And I thank you so much for just, again, being our Savior, being the one who sacrificed himself upon the cross, rising again. Thank you for also being our friend, for knowing that we can turn to you in times of trouble and woe, that you understand our problems and our pain because you've been through it yourself. Lord, thank you so much again for reminding us of that hope we have built upon you being our solid rock. Thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Covenant, his blood, support me.
Let's close our time together in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the reminder from the Word of God this morning that we serve a risen Savior. And we praise you. We give you all the glory that knowing that Jesus died for us and that he rose again, we have that hope of having that same resurrection and that same resurrected body. And Lord, we want to give you all the glory and all the praise for your plan of salvation centered around Christ. And Lord, may it also remind us to continue to follow Christ, to live for him, to be a faithful disciple. And Lord, we pray that you would find each one of us drawing closer and closer to Jesus Christ every day. And Lord, we would also pray, as was mentioned, that if there's anyone here today without Christ as their Savior, that they would look to the crucified Jesus and see that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through him. And Lord, we pray that they may, even now, receive that wonderful gift of salvation and know that great hope of someday being with Christ and being like Christ. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.